there's a memory of being young in all of our bodies that we just have to tell reset, take a pill, and we become like Deadpool, and we can regrow things. We don't know how many times you can press the reset button and restore the hard drive. It could be once, we've done that. Maybe it's 100 times.
Oh my gosh.
But it gets even crazier when we can actually change the genome. We don't just read it, we write it. There are drugs on the market, most people may not realize, we are changing people's genetic diseases. We're curing genetic diseases. Yes. We are living in the future, man.
This is a revolutionary conversation for me. Welcome back to Max Out, everybody. The man to my right, I chased down today because today's show is for me, everybody, and you guys get to listen in because we're gonna talk about anti-aging. We're gonna talk about living longer. We're gonna talk about living better. And the man to my right is the foremost expert, I think, on the spinning earth today in this area. He's a Harvard professor. He's one of Time Magazine's most influential people. He's been knighted in his home country of Australia. And he's kind of an unbelievable combination of part scientist, part businessman, and an unbelievable best-selling author, international best-selling author of this book, Lifespan, everybody, that I want you to get, Why We Age and Why We Don't Have To. And that's what we're going to talk about today is you not having to age and how we can help you with that. So Dr. Sinclair, David, thank you for
being
here.
Call me David. Thanks, Ed, for having me here.
Going forward, it will be David. So
please.
Thank you. Combined IQ, very high today, guys, and he's holding up 85% of it, so. let's talk first off about, because this is heavy note-taking probably for the audience today. I want to talk first off about aging and how we measure it, because, you know, I'm not sure, you know, if we're going to not age or we're going to reverse our age, there has to be a calibration method. And I'm wondering when you do that, is that telomeres? Because I know you talk about the Horvath clock also in your book.
Right.
How do you measure aging?
Well, we used to just look at people and that person looks kind of old, that person doesn't.
Right.
Then we had telomeres, which was all the rage in the 1990s. Actually, telomeres aren't the whole rage anymore. There's a new way of measuring aging. And it's this Horvath clock you mentioned.
Okay.
So the Horvath clock has revolutionized our ability to design ways to slow down and in my lab, accelerate aging. We can measure it. I could take your blood today. Maybe I should. Take some back to my lab. And I could measure your actual biological age. So forget about candles, they're irrelevant. I could measure this Horvath clock and I could tell you not just how old you are biologically, but how long you're gonna live and when you're gonna die.
When you're gonna die.
Yeah, very accurately. It's scary, but this clock actually tells us, I think, about what the process of aging is. Why do we age in the first place?
So it's not, telomeres is sort of old school now? Is that what you're saying?
Well, you know, I try not to just be black and white about this, but telomeres is certainly not the whole story of aging anymore.
So in general, then we're gonna get very specific. Why do we age? How do we age?
Well, so this is what's in my book, which is I've kept bottled up an idea about aging and we studied it for 10 years and kept it secret. And it all just flowed out onto the page in the book. And we have all this research to back it up. What I'm proposing is that there are lots of different causes of aging. Telomere loss is another, is a main one. There's stem cell loss, senescent cells, so zombie cells that accumulate, all these things. We actually, as a field, I'm a scientist, first and foremost, we declared victory over aging about 10 years ago. We said, there are 8 causes of aging. Let's put them in a pie chart. We're done, we know what causes aging. And I'm there thinking, that's great, but what causes those things?
Right.
Is there a unified theory of aging?
Okay.
And that's what I've got in the book. It's called the information theory of aging. And it can explain, I think, why all of those things happen. So instead of building 9 dams or 8 dams on 8 tributaries, we may be able to go all the way up and stop the main driver of what causes us to get old.
So I want to go through a couple of the things. By the way, the book, by the way, now has an audio version that's been updated as well. And I really recommend you all, if you have the book, is go get a look at the new audiobook and listen to that because there's a whole new thing in the book there that he's added as well. But I want to go through some of the basic things you've covered because some of these things I do and I'm wondering if they're still effective and I'm wondering if I shouldn't be doing them anymore. But one of the things I was prescribed, I have had a touch of arteriosclerosis in my life And one of the things my cardiologist was concerned about was inflammation in my body. And so I was prescribed metformin.
Yeah.
In an effort to reduce inflammation in my body. And I'm wondering all of your thoughts on metformin, because it's at the kind of the, it's part of the book, and it's also part of a lot of the conversation about anti-aging, glucose regulation, and those kind of things.
Yeah, so the thing with metformin that everyone needs to know, and will know if they get the book, is that there are three main ways to slow down aging, three genetic pathways. I work on one pathway called the sirtuins, mm-hmm. which we can talk about later, but yeah. they're a crux of defending against aging. There are two others. One responds to how much protein you eat, and the third one responds to how much energy, chemical energy is in your body. That's metformin.
Okay.
So metformin will trick your body into thinking there's not enough energy, and it'll respond and actually make your body, mm-hmm. we think, fight against aging,
right.
And particularly type 2 diabetes. So metformin is a drug that came out from the French lilac. It's originally a natural molecule, but it was tweaked a bit, so it's now a drug. You need a prescription. But I'm shocked. Are you still taking metformin?
I'm not.
Ah, well, all right. We need to talk.
Okay.
But I'm not an MD. But
why should we talk? Should I be still taking it?
I don't make any recommendations.
In general.
But what I do is I take it.
You do?
Yeah, I don't leave home without it.
Can I tell you why I stopped? And you can correct me.
Sure.
Okay. I stopped because I started to read at least anecdotal evidence, because I do lift weights.
Yep.
I'm an athlete. I'd like to think of myself as an athlete, even though I'm pushing 50 years old. That it may have some negative implications on athletic performance and or recovery.
All right, so now we're really jumping in fast.
All right. There we go.
All right, so
I've been waiting for today for a long time, sorry.
Yeah, so metformin, what it does is it inhibits your mitochondria, it makes your body think you don't have enough energy, and your body will respond accordingly, and you become what's called insulin sensitive. You'll have low glucose levels in your body, and it'll prevent type 2 diabetes.
Right.
What we also know from studies of 10,000 up to 100,000 people in some studies, people who take metformin seem to be protected not just against diabetes, but against heart disease, cancer, frailty, and Alzheimer's. That's all good. That's what you find in an anti-aging or longevity pill.
Okay.
Metformin's great because it's, as far as we know, pretty safe. It's been taken by probably 100 million people around the world. It's on the list of the World Health Organization's list of essential medicines for humanity. Hmm. So it's pretty good. You're not going to die from it. Mm. It's very rare. Consult a doctor as you did.
Okay.
But I was surprised that your doctor put you on metformin even though you didn't have diabetes. That's very rare.
The reason was, and I won't say her name, but I think she's sort of at the cutting edge of this, and she really does believe that one of the greatest risks to my health or anybody's health is developing type 2 diabetes.
Great. So your doctor knows a lot more than most doctors?
Correct. Most cardiologists, it's Lipitor and Crestor and, you know, don't eat a steak.
Exactly. And, right. and their view, and I train a lot of doctors and work with them, but their view is unless you pass the threshold of a disease, we won't treat it.
Mm-hmm.
But metformin will prevent diabetes as well and get your glucose levels. And actually the best predictor of longevity right now, besides this clock, is your blood glucose levels. You want to keep them down.
Okay.
You do not want to go up. And I was going up and up and up. So I started taking metformin a couple of years ago.
You do.
And ostensibly my biological age, based on different tests, mm-hmm. not the clock, but the other tests, went from 58 down to 31.4.
It's incredible. And you look 31.4 and I look 58. So I need to get back on metformin.
No, I was joking with Ed that I needed to wear this padded suit so that I don't look such a wimp.
Oh, well, I think you look
great. No, you're looking great.
Thank you.
But let's get back to the muscles. So this is called hypertrophy, mm-hmm. muscular hypertrophy, mm-hmm. which is great.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to look like you, mm-hmm. and I just don't have the time to do it. But it's great. Plus, you will be much stronger when you're older, which is key to living longer.
Bone density, things of that sort.
All of that's great. Right. And actually, one of the things we like to say in my field is the best way to live a long life is to hang on to the handrail, which basically means don't slip and break your femur or you're done for, like my grandmother.
Right.
But let's get into something really important. A lot of people aren't sure about metformin because there were two studies just this year that showed that it slows muscle hypertrophy.
Right.
But here's the good news.
Okay.
And I know the world's experts in this, and I've talked to the authors of the paper. So here's the scoop.
All right.
First time.
It's awesome.
All right, you're getting this the first time.
This is awesome.
What they found, and this is also work that's not yet out, so let me give you the scoop.
Okay.
The patients that got metformin and those that didn't, they all got bigger muscles and they all got stronger. Okay. One group got slightly bigger muscles. That was the group on placebo. and those on metformin didn't get so big. But when they did the strength test, they were equal.
Wow.
So they're all strong.
Wow.
They may not look as good.
Okay.
So I think it's a vanity versus longevity decision.
Okay.
But I think there's a way around this as well. Now, we're on the cutting edge, so we don't know for sure. But what I do is when I work out, I stop taking metformin, let my body recover for a couple of days, okay. and then I go back on it.
Ah.
And, you know, Peter Attia, the good doctor who studies this, we both agree that you don't want to be taking the same medicine every day necessarily, just as you don't want to work out every day. You need to give your body a rest.
Okay.
So, you know, we cycle.
So in between workouts, you might, if someone works out, let's say Monday, Wednesday, Friday, you might suggest that the workout days specifically, they not take something like metformin on those days.
Well, that's what I do.
Okay.
That's based on everything we know in the world right now.
Okay. And then, by the way, thank you for that. You guys, first off, I'm so grateful that you exist because, no, we were talking about this off camera too, that this whole field that you're in is moving so quickly and you're at the cutting edge of it. And I think every person listening to this, regardless of they want to live healthier, they also want to live longer. But as they live longer, they want to be able to, they want to, I've already looked at it differently. I look different. I love my dad, but I look different at 48 than my dad did at 48. You know what I'm saying? I think athletically, physically, sure. my strength level. And I think what's possible with somebody like you, like right now, if someone did all the things that are in your book, if they put the right formula together, not only do you think they can not be aging, but what's the window of time they might be able to reverse their aging by? I know that's by person, but in general, yeah. how many years can someone reel off their life or add to their life rather?
Right. Well, so someone like me doesn't typically exist because they're scared of what our colleagues will say. And it's pretty rough for a scientist to be out there talking about things that are really on the cutting edge and projecting into the
future. And to some extent, speculative still, correct?
Right.
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 Based on evidence, but speculative.
But how selfish is it for me and my family?
Right.
To reap the benefits, we're all scientists in my family. Mm. We're on similar programs. How selfish is that for me to keep that bottled up? I want to tell the world what I'm learning.
It's wonderful.
And we're in a world where now everybody can learn as fast as I'm learning and what I'm doing. Mm. And that's I feel an obligation to do that. But what about talking about the metformin, mm-hmm. the story?
Two and a half years it says it takes off, or adds well, to. So if you're-
it can.
Right.
Yeah.
Theoretically, if you're 50, you're now 47 and a half. If you're on the normal yeah. dose of metformin is what they're saying. But we don't really know.
We don't know
what it's gonna do to diminish your ability to get type 2 diabetes, what that could do, heart disease, all the inflammation in your body because of yeah. these glucose spikes, correct? Yes.
Well, so here's the most important take home message is that only 20% of your longevity and how you'll feel when you're 70 and 80 and 90 is genetic.
Okay.
The rest is in your hands.
Wow.
Isn't that, that's liberating.
Yes.
I mean, you can sit on the couch, you can eat potato chips, you can not exercise, you can eat whatever you want, but you're minimizing your potential.
Right.
And what we all have in our bodies, what we co-discovered in my lab is that there are genes that control how long we live. We work on these pathways. Mm. And what we've discovered is they don't just exist, they respond to how we live. Hmm. And what we want to do is trick our bodies into thinking there's adversity.
Hmm.
Biological stress, not emotional stress, but biological stress.
Okay.
So now we understand why does exercise make us healthier and live longer? Why does being hungry make us live longer? Why do all these things, eating good foods, it's because they're turning on these body defenses, these longevity genes that we work on.
Hmm.
And that's the revelation. They're in all of us, but they become complacent unless we trick our bodies into getting this feeling of adversity.
Adversity.
So we call this hormesis.
Okay.
Hormesis is what doesn't kill you makes you live longer. And that's the reason you should be running and getting out of breath. That's the reason you should be eating plants that have been stressed themselves. You get the benefits of those molecules that they make for their own benefit.
Okay.
We call that xenohormesis. Terrible, terrible word, but anyway, it's good to eat stressed plants. Like, that's why red wine's good for you, we believe. It's full of those molecules.
Thank God. Thank God.
Yeah, so resveratrol, you'll remember.
Yes. Where are you? So let's go there. You're famous for that. And I got the feeling lately, maybe you're not as married to it as you once were, or am I incorrect about that? And then for those of you that are taking resveratrol, is it also not true that if you're not doing something that can make it bind to something so that it can be absorbed by your body, do you mind talking about that for a second? Because people just kind of willy-nilly take these pills, I think, to some extent, and think they're doing something. So A, do you still feel as strong about it as you did at one time?
Mm-hmm.
And B, could you tell us how to properly ingest it?
Sure.
Thank you.
All right. So I also dodged the question, not intentionally. of how far can we slow and reverse aging.
You did. I'm sorry. You're right. I let you dodge that.
Well, I
try. Because I'm so fascinated.
I worry because people say, oh, how can you say that?
Right.
Right. So this is my best guess, is that you can alter your lifespan at least a decade by how you live your life, maybe more.
Wow.
And my father is an example of someone who took life by the horns, changed his life. He's super fit. He's now 80. He's living life like he was 30 still. He's got no diseases.
Is that right?
He just put his name on a wait list for his dream car. I'm thinking, a wait list? You're optimistic.
That is awesome.
He started a new career. Really, this is the future for all of us if we look after our bodies and do what we think is the right thing.
Love it.
Right. So that I think that 10 years is
10 years is at least, based on current science, something right. You could be doing.
Right. And actually, every 4 years longer we live, we gain another year, just because the trajectory of the science, how it's going.
And we're going to talk about CRISPR a little bit later, where we might be able to interrupt heart disease and some other things here going forward that'll extend life. My God, it could be 3 decades. But go ahead, go on resveratrol, if you would.
So resveratrol is this molecule in red wine that is thought to protect the French from high-fat foods.
Yeah.
And we discovered that it activates an enzyme in the body called SIRT1, one of these sirtuin protective enzymes that's activated by hunger and exercise.
Okay.
So resveratrol we discovered as the first molecule that could mimic a calorically restricted diet and exercise. This wasn't an excuse to just sit on the couch and eat pop a pill, because we actually found that if mice took resveratrol and exercised and ate a healthy diet, they lived the longest.
Okay.
So it's a combination, but you want to keep these enzymes active, because as we get older, these defensive enzymes like SIRT1, they go down in their activity.
Okay.
So there are two ways to keep SIRT1 super active, besides living the healthy lifestyle that many of us know about and is in my book, page 302, 303.
Unbelievable.
Jump to the, because some people, they just want the facts.
Right,
just
right.
want the list.
Right.
But resveratrol is a remarkable molecule because plants make it to survive, because plants have SIRT2 and longevity enzymes as well.
Okay.
But when we ingest that, we get the benefits.
Okay. Right?
So you said I was not as hot on that.
Yeah.
What happened was...
Yeah, okay, I was right.
What happened was all of us who have been blessed to be successful in what we do have gone through really hard times.
Mm-hmm.
And I had my moment, the worst time of my life, in 2010. So I'd spent...
What was it? Do you mind saying what it was?
Yeah, sure. So I had discovered resveratrol activates anti-aging pathways. We'd shown that it extended lifespan in everything from a yeast cell to a worm to a fly to a mouse, protected them against a Western diet, and even extended their lifespan when we gave it to them every other day.
Okay.
That was great. We developed drugs that were showing efficacy, working in humans to treat a disease called psoriasis,
yes.
which is inflammation on the skin.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was looking like we were going to be the first people to make a drug that treats aging on the market.
Okay.
And then a couple of companies, for reasons that we can only speculate, came out with their science and said, it's all wrong. Everything David said is wrong.
I remember that.
It blew up.
Yep, I remember that.
It trashed the trials, and I was the pariah of the scientific world. And it was tough. I spent a week in bed. I couldn't get out of bed. It was real depression. And I was really angry with the world, I'll admit, because here I am trying to do my best.
Right.
I'm putting my life aside. I'm putting my family aside to help the world, like you do.
Yes.
Well, maybe not your family, but you know, we want to help
exactly
the world.
I know exactly what you mean.
And then everyone said, ha ha, you're wrong, screw you. And it was tough. But you know, my passion is to leave the world a better place.
Yeah, this is your calling, obviously.
So I couldn't stay in bed.
Awesome.
You know, that to me is worse than death, is just sitting there.
Hope everybody just heard that.
Yeah, right. It really is. You got to have, my mission is to change the world in this way. So got out of bed and spent the next 3 years testing whether what these companies were saying, and I'll say who they were, Pfizer and Amgen, both didn't agree with us. But what it did, and the silver lining was, it forced us to do even better science and go back and test our hypothesis very, very rigorously. And we put out a paper in the journal Science, which is the best in the US, best in the world probably, showing that we were right, that resveratrol really was activating this enzyme and wasn't what the naysayers were saying. But you know what? In the media, there were crickets. No one cares about the comeback guy.
Right, that's right.
They just cared about the fall.
Right.
So what we've done over the last, 7 years, is we've been testing this even more rigorously.
Okay.
I'll tell you what we've done.
Okay.
We've created a mouse. We can genetically create mice with very specific changes.
Okay.
We change the mouse by changing one amino acid, one part of this protein. So you don't mind if I get a little bit technical here?
Do it.
All right.
Please.
So the enzymes are basically machines that change other proteins.
Okay.
And SIRT1, it's the traffic cop. It tells the body to fight diseases, fight aging.
Okay.
But to do that, it has to move. It has to change things. Okay. And what it does is it has this active enzyme activity in the middle of, that's its chest. But this arm is the activator. This is the gas, the accelerator pedal.
Okay.
So the accelerator pedal is pushed by resveratrol. Resveratrol come in.
I get
stick
it.
Stick here.
Yep.
Push the accelerator. And now the SIRT1 enzyme is fighting against disease.
Okay.
Now we figured out that you can block this step by changing one little thing. Give it tennis elbow. It can't bend the elbow. Now resveratrol cannot work anymore.
Got it.
So we made a mouse that was unable to bend this arm and activate. So the accelerator pedal, we took it out of the system. Mm. The mouse is otherwise normal.
Mm.
Doesn't have the accelerator pedal though.
Mm.
So if we're wrong and we give resveratrol to these mice, they won't live longer on a high fat diet, Western diet. If we're right, resveratrol won't work at all.
Okay.
And we got the second result, 100%.
Mm.
And that's as close to proof that we were right in the first place. So what I'm hoping is that'll reinvigorate the field and we'll get those drugs back into those clinical trials.
Okay.
But I haven't been sitting on my hands. I've been working on other molecules that seem to have a lot of promise and maybe even better than the original discovery.
Such as?
Well, we call them NAD boosters or NADs. Some people call them NADs. So there are two ways to activate these protective enzymes. One is the accelerator pedal.
Yep.
The other is the gas that comes in through here. And without either of those, you don't have hyperactive system.
Okay.
And as we get older, we lose this NAD.
Yeah.
So it's estimated that by the time you're my age, 50, and you're getting close,
right
you have about half the levels you did of NAD when you were young, when you were 20.
Okay.
So of course your defenses against aging are going to be about half the levels that they were.
Mm-hmm.
So there are some ways to keep your NAD levels relatively high.
Okay.
One is to exercise, lose your breath, work out.
Lose your breath. You said that a couple times.
Yeah. So you want to lose your breath.
So not walking cardio, lose your breath cardio.
Yeah, that's the best way, at least based on the animal studies we've done and some human studies.
Okay.
And then the second is you want to be hungry. At least part of the day, and that'll raise the levels of.
What do you mean by that? Like, so do you believe in intermittent fasting, or do you?
I do.
You do.
I do. We used to restrict calories the whole day.
Yeah.
In these what we call calorie restriction,
mm-hmm.
and that was the paradigm for about 70 years actually.
Okay.
And then just in the last 10 years, we've realized, hey, you don't need to always be hungry.
Okay.
You can actually eat a decent meal or two.
Okay.
But don't eat three meals a day. Don't always snack.
Okay.
Because being hungry is what turns on these protective enzymes.
Mm.
And so I've now shifted my life to eating small meals. What I do is I skip breakfast as best I can.
Yeah.
Eat a very late lunch or even forget to eat lunch and then eat a normal dinner.
This is more and more. So that Dr. Ian Smith that I told you was on my show, his book was about intermittent fasting, but the aging benefit was never discussed.
Yeah.
We discussed the health benefit, although I'm sure Ian's aware of it. It's not something that we discussed. Just to put a loop on resveratrol, what about the way you take it? Is it important? Yeah. I was reading that you thought something about taking it with either like a yogurt or a milk or something it can bind to.
Exactly.
And why does that matter?
Well, so there are clinical trials over the last 10 years based on our research, and some have failed and some have succeeded.
Okay.
And the main reason that they've failed, in my view, is that doctors who don't understand resveratrol have just given the pill with water. And resveratrol is the equivalent of brick dust. It's like eating sand, right? We're here on the beach.
Okay.
If you eat sand, you're not going to absorb it.
Okay.
But if you crush up the sand and mix it with things, you might absorb a little bit.
All right.
That's what we do with resveratrol. And what I do personally is I have this amazing yogurt that I make myself.
Okay.
And I mix it with that and it dissolves beautifully. Okay. And I have a couple of spoons of that.
So if I'm taking a pill, could I take it with a yogurt? Is that what you're suggesting?
That would work in your stomach.
Okay. Okay.
I have powder in my basement, so I just spoon it in.
Okay.
I take about half a gram to a gram.
Okay. Awesome.
But yeah, you got to do that. And so the recent studies that have actually included resveratrol with a meal have succeeded in lowering blood sugar.
Got it.
And there are actually now, I was just at a meeting in Washington, D.C., where they have beautiful clinical data showing that it works like metformin to reduce blood sugar as
well. So this blood sugar concept, because that's my cardiologist, is a big thing too. This is just going to be huge throughout everything that we're learning about the body and keeping it stable and not aging and also not even turning on certain. Can inflammation of the body speed up turning on a genetic code that's already in there?
Absolutely. Yeah. That's a really good point. The inflammation is a problem because if you have inflammation, it'll also shut down these defenses against aging,
okay.
and that'll lead to more inflammation and just accelerate aging.
Okay.
You know, we know that we get to about 40 and we're still pretty good. We get to 50 and we're starting to feel a little different, looking different.
That's absolutely true.
And then you fall off a cliff.
Yes.
That's this positive feedback of inflammation, shutting down longevity genes, and vice versa.
Okay.
And it just, once you're on that,
I have found that those things, and we're gonna talk about them later, like my vision, other signs of aging, really started to accelerate in my mid to late 40s, approaching 50. Right. I mean, massive difference. So I didn't mean to interrupt you there, but it's certainly something I've seen evidentiary, like my own experience as a human. Yeah. I feel myself aging now at this point.
Yeah, so there are things you can do to slow that down.
Right.
And things that we're doing that slow and reverse aspects, and then technology that can reverse all aspects.
Okay, let's keep talking about that. By the way, everybody, this is one of these shows. My audience loves this, just so you know. So many of them are driving right now. They're gonna go back. This is watch it again or listen to it again, and you're taking all these notes. So I wanna go through a couple other specific things. We've talked about resveratrol. We've talked about metformin. There's sort of this cocktail sort of that you suggest to some extent. I wanna talk about growth hormone for a second. What are your feelings about growth hormone, both taking an exogenous version or doing things that may, if it even works, of growing your own, and why is growth hormone so important or not important?
Yeah, so in my field of aging research, it's debated tremendously. Mm-hmm. And most of the debate comes from studies of animals. Mm-hmm. And what we find is that animals that have low levels of growth hormone live longer. So there's this—
Low levels live longer.
Right.
Okay.
But there's something that my colleagues don't appreciate, and that is a lifelong treatment of a lifelong existence with low growth hormone, what you end up with is dwarfism. So small animals, due to a lack of development, live long.
Oh, wow.
Okay. It's also, by the way, known that the smaller you are, you tend to live longer.
Mm-hmm.
That we know that from pet dogs. Mm-hmm. If you ever had a large dog, you know the problem. So the reason is that during development, we're actually slowing down the clock. And the clock is changing when you're young as well. But what I believe anyway, is having read thousands of papers on this topic, is that growth hormone isn't bad, but it won't make you live longer.
Okay.
Because what it's doing is some benefits. It's gonna improve your body's metabolism, it can help you grow muscle. But what it's not doing is turning on the longevity genes, which is what you need to do, the kind of things that I'm doing to get those active as well.
Okay.
So what's exciting to me is maybe you could take growth hormone, but then trick the body into thinking that it's lacking growth hormone and that you're exercising tremendously.
How would you do that?
Trick it?
Yeah.
Well, what I do is the combination of the metformin with the resveratrol, and there's an NAD booster, which I take. Those are the three main components. Okay. By the way, I don't recommend anybody do anything. I'm a PhD, not a doctor.
Right.
But I feel an obligation to say what I do.
And by the way, one other thing, there's all these companies out there suggesting that your name's on them, but you're not involved with any particular company that's NAD that they could purchase right now,
are you? No, I'm glad you mentioned that, Ed, because if you look on the internet, you might think that I have 10 companies.
You would.
There's even a Sinclair lab. Somebody started a company with my name on there.
My goodness.
So I don't do that, and there's a very good reason for that.
Okay.
It's because I need to be able to give you my unbiased scientific opinion. Okay. And if I have some favorites, why would you trust what I'm saying?
Good point. Okay, so we got the growth hormone answer. Okay, my age, you find a dude looking like me, that dude may have had an interest in hormone replacement. And I'm wondering your thoughts on that. So I've had people say to me, as your hormones in your body diminish, you are aging. And so for that reason, in the anti-aging movement, particularly testosterone therapy for both men and women now is a pretty highly prescribed and recommended protocol as their own levels drop. What are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, I think that makes perfect sense to me.
Okay.
There are two points. One is that maintain what you've lost. Okay. I think it makes perfect sense.
Okay.
Testosterone and growth hormone.
Okay.
But don't think that they're gonna make you live longer. That's not the solution.
Okay.
I think you need to combine that with these other things that will put your body in a defensive state.
Okay.
Because testosterone and growth hormone, they're gonna do the opposite. They're gonna put your body in the growth reproduction state, which is great when you're young, but it's not gonna extend your lifespan.
Do you believe, is it a wives' tale that either testosterone or the growth hormone may grow organs in your body, or do we not know? In other words, the heart might expand to a dangerous extent, And secondly, I just love asking you this stuff, sorry. Yeah. And secondly, the potentially, if you were to develop cancer or a tumor, that it could accelerate the speed of which the disease manifests itself in your body. Do we know? Do we have an idea? Do you have an opinion about it?
Yeah. So it's debated. So there is, okay. the truth is we don't actually know.
Okay.
But I've read all the literature, and, okay. and my personal take on the science is that it's not a risk okay. to develop tumors. But if you have a tumor, then I think then you get serious with your doctor, and okay. I think you stop this stuff.
Okay.
But everything I've seen is that the things that you and I do, they're not going to make things worse. Mm. But if something's detected, then we're in new territory. So for instance, NAD boosters, I take those. Mm-hmm. If you give those to mice, they have new blood vessels. It's like a super drug for athletes.
Okay.
They can run further.
Okay.
But it also, you don't want extra blood vessels growing in your tumor. Right?
Okay. Good point.
So I think that with an abundance of caution, anyone who has a tumor, don't take these things.
Okay.
But it's not going to necessarily grow a tumor
okay.
if you don't have one already.
Wonderful. Okay. So let's talk. By the way, thank you. Are you having as much fun doing this as I am? Because you know all this stuff already.
Well, this is one of the best interviews I've done because we're getting into all sorts of things that I usually don't get asked about.
Wonderful. Let's talk about aging for a second. So as we're measuring aging, I've read some things. So understanding what's happening, could you explain to us, is it the cell's inability to now read the DNA like it used to? Or what's happening that's causing this to happen in our body, and is what I just said completely ridiculous?
No, it's correct.
Good.
We're done. We're done here. Ed's going to do the rest of the interview by himself. No, it's serious. Seriously, okay. you summed it up probably better than I could,
okay.
which is the analogy I use is a DVD, these old things you used to put movies on.
Okay.
Any kids watching or listening, these are old things you used to put digital information on, but they're a good analogy because you can actually scratch them.
Okay.
Right. And so a DVD is the digital information, and our genome, our DNA, is digital. Instead of zeros and ones, it's ATCG chemicals. That information is actually very robust. You can get it out of an old person, it's intact mostly. You can get it out of a fossil. It lasts for thousands, if not millions of years. That's the cool thing about digital information.
Okay.
It lasts. There's another type of information that controls the reading of those genes.
Yeah.
We call that not the genetic, but the epigenetic information. Mm-hmm. And epigenetic basically says, how is the DNA organized so a cell reads the right genes at the right time? Mm-hmm. And we don't know as much about it because it's much harder to read the epigenome than the genome.
Okay.
The reason is the epigenome is not digital information, it's actually analog. Mm. It sucks. Anyone who's had a cassette tape or a phonograph or a record player is actually experiencing the problems with analog information.
Okay.
There's generations of people now that have never experienced analog in their lives. Mm. But trust me, analog sucks. And our bodies, half of the information in our bodies is analog.
Okay.
And that's the problem. That's why we age.
Okay.
Because the analog, we have an analog system that reads the DNA. Mm. And over time, it doesn't read the right genes at the right time anymore.
Yeah. Okay.
And cells, when they don't read the right genes, they don't function well. Mm. So our blood glucose goes up, we get weak, we get diseases.
Mm.
That's aging. But also what happens is that the cells forget what type of cells they are.
Yeah.
They despecialize. We call it ex-differentiation. Mm. Essentially, we become a melange, a collection of cells that have forgotten what kind of cells they should be.
Got you.
And that is pretty bad news, right?
Yes.
If you scratch a DVD, you're in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
We've been looking for the polish on that DVD, and I think we found it.
Okay, and it is?
Well, we call it reprogramming, genetic or epigenetic reprogramming. And it's a set of genes that we can put into cells or into the eye of a mouse and reset the age of that animal. Remember that clock that we're going to measure on you?
Yes.
We call that the epigenetic clock for a good reason because it's actually the analog changes in the cell, right?
Okay.
But here's what we can do. We can actually tell the cell, now that you're old and you're not reading the right genes, go back and read the genes the way you should.
Okay.
It's essentially polishing the DVD. Another way to think of it is we're rebooting the cell.
Yes.
We've got corrupted software. Screw that. Mm-hmm. Let's restart the whole computer.
Okay.
And you're young again.
Okay.
Right? Erase the hard drive, start again.
Wow.
But we didn't know that was possible until a year ago.
Wow.
That's what's in the book. I was writing the book as we made these discoveries.
Wow. Wow.
Imagine that. There's a memory of being young in all of our bodies that we just have to tell reset.
Oh my gosh. And so do you mind naming the company that you're involved with that I was reading about that had something to do with the retina, or you're working on it specifically with eyes. Is that not right?
Yeah, that's right. Okay. So it's still in stealth mode.
Yeah. This is incredible.
But I'll reveal it to all your listeners the first time. It's called Iduna, and it's interesting. The first part of it is eye, because we're going to treat glaucoma.
Oh my gosh, this is huge. Yeah.
And then Iduna is also the Norse goddess of longevity. But here's what we want to do. And I'm an entrepreneur just like you, because I believe not just in making discoveries, but making them practical for people. Mm-hmm. Iduna is planning and working towards treating the loss of vision in people.
This is unbelievable.
But if we can reverse aging in the eye, what can't we reverse aging in? So it's early days, but what we've just discovered, and we have a scientific paper, if you Google my name, you'll find it.
Okay.
We were able to reprogram the retina of an old mouse that couldn't see very well anymore to be young again. So the nerves in the back of the eye, they became young, and these mice completely got their vision back.
This is unbelievable. This is one of the... This may be one of the most exciting things that we're on the brink of, that you're at the forefront of on the planet right now. And the reason it's important to me, it's funny, as I've aged, I had perfect vision. You know, as a baseball player, unreal vision. I could read a street sign from miles away. I don't know if it's miles away, but far away. And people say, how do you see like this? And now I'm finding I can't read the street sign from 30 feet away. This area where I'm most aware of my aging is in my ability to see. And I have a sister, I haven't told you this, who is juvenile diabetes, born without a pancreas that functioned. And she's gotten to the point where essentially in long stages of her life, she's been completely blind and now sees just to some extent. And so do you think that there's even properties eventually with people with, massive retina deterioration, you believe is gonna be something that could be reversible at some point?
So I don't want to overpromise, because it's just a year old and we're making discoveries pretty fast, but it's still in animals. Mm-hmm. But let's just suspend all sorts of disbelief right now and talk about what's possible.
Possible.
So what I can tell you is the reason that you and I are losing our vision, the reason we have to do this at night, is because the nerves in the back of our eye are not youthful anymore, and they're forgetting that they're nerves.
Right, as we said earlier, yes.
And if I reprogram your eye just with an injection, what I think would happen is that you'd get, those nerves would say, oh shit, I got to work well again. That I think we can do. Our nerves in our eye are no different than a mouse's eye, really.
Okay.
But we did another experiment. We crushed the back of the optic nerve. We really, like you crush your spine, it's not going to grow back unless you're a baby. Mm-hmm. We reversed the age of those nerves so much that they actually started growing back to the brain even after we killed them.
Oh my gosh.
Or we crushed them.
Oh my gosh. So if you could do that in an eye, as you said, where else could that eventually be applicable in the body? You guys, unbelievable. Now we're not talking a decade. Now we're talking, we're potentially talking people living extremely long lifespans. What's doxycycline?
Doxycycline is an antibiotic that you take for Lyme disease and some other infections. It's pretty common.
But what's the application here?
Well, so we engineered our treatment so that we put the genes in the eye.
Yes.
And then we give the mice doxycycline for 3 weeks.
Okay.
And that turns on the genes.
Okay.
They get their vision back. Then we turn it off again by taking away the antibiotic.
Got it.
So here's a future scenario.
Wow.
We can put those genes into our whole body. And as we get older, or God forbid, we break our back or we injure ourselves and we're not going to survive, we get an IV of doxycycline or we take a pill and we become like Deadpool, and we can regrow things like an axolotl would chop their limb off and they grow again.
Oh my God.
And then we stop taking the antibiotic, we're young, and then we can wait another few decades.
Right, do it again.
Right. So here's the cool thing. And I'm going to mention this in my social media because we don't know the answer yet, but I'll keep you updated. I'll give you a call. I'd love to come back on. We don't know how many times you can press the reset button and restore the hard drive. It could be once. We've done that. Maybe it's 100 times.
Oh my gosh. I'm not a skeptic. I think sometimes my mind goes to what's the problem with that? And I think about is there even enough food in the world if people are living 200, 300, and 400 years long? Have you thought through some of those issues? That's something you don't even think about.
No, I think about it all the time.
You do?
Yeah, because it's the planet and humanity that I care
about. Water and food, right? There's a finite amount of that, at least right now.
Well, so I talk about this in my book also, because we can't just solve aging and make people live a decade or more longer without tackling the other problems we have. But what I've done is the calculations and the rationale comes out that this is the best thing we can do for the planet. Now, it sounds crazy, right? That if we have people living longer, how is that going to help? Well, first of all, it doesn't raise the population that much. In fact, most countries are leveling off anyway.
Okay.
Even if we stopped aging today, the rate of population growth isn't that much. Yeah. There aren't that many old people that are dying, actually. It's actually less than the rate of immigration right now. Yeah. And there are a lot of countries that need help. Japan is losing its population, Europe as well. So there's that. But talk about consumption. We throw away half our food in this country. We got to fix that first.
Sure.
Right? But the biggest thing, the big takeaway message is, if we can keep people healthier for longer and just have them die in a matter of months at the end, which is what happens if you live to 100.
I understand now. Okay. Yeah? I get it.
So centenarians, we call them, people who make it over 100, they die quickly, usually have a heart attack or a kidney failure. They cost at least one third less than the rest of us.
I get it.
Let's get us all there.
I just got it.
Yeah. Okay. That's trillions of dollars saving. We already waste a lot of money on healthcare.
Yeah.
Keeping people alive for 10 years in nursing homes. I think we all have a duty to keep ourselves healthy for longer, if not for ourselves, but for our children and our grandkids who have to take care of us for 10 years.
This is a revolutionary conversation for me. It's a paradigm shifting conversation, because some of the things we've discussed today, everyone, I want to go back. You have to get this book. You have to get this book. You have to be following this man on social media, and you're going to want to get the next one. This is someone that if you want to live better, longer, healthier, you want to stay close to this man, because obviously he's going to live for a whole long time. And he's at the cutting edge of all of these things we've talked about. I want people to dream for a minute. Then I'm going to go for a question about, I don't have a lot of money and I want to begin to live longer. But I want to go to one more thing, just because I want people to understand some of the possibilities out there. Talk to them about CRISPR just a little bit, because this is, combined with what you just described, something that is, you begin to think through all of the technological advances in the world. But in terms of this space, we may be entering the, if we want to call it the internet age of anti-aging right now. We may be sitting on the Apples and the Microsoft concepts, the Googles of anti-aging right now in some of these spaces. And these will change people's lives. So tell them about CRISPR just for a second.
Yeah, right. So we've gone through what we can do today in our daily lives.
Right.
And there's cutting edge technology that I talk about in my book, and we just talked about, that's coming very soon.
Yes.
And there's medicines already that you can possibly take. But the future looks incredible. I've already said that even if we don't have these breakthroughs, every 4 years we get to live longer, we get another year of life. That's great. But what's coming makes my head spin. And I've been at the cutting edge of genetics for the last 30 years. And I just can't believe, every morning I wake up and I pinch myself that we're living in the future already. But what's coming blows my mind. So in my department at Harvard Medical School, I get to work with people who grow eyes in a dish and people who work on all sorts of futuristic stuff, growing brains in a dish. George Church is one of my good friends and colleagues. He's just, my lab's just on the different floor than his in the same building. So he's one of the guys that, women as well, there were a team of people that showed that you could actually edit the human genome.
This is huge.
So we can now read the genome. Instead of $1 billion to read your genome, I can do it in my lab for a device that big.
Right now.
For $100.
Right.
I can do that today.
Yes.
And soon it'll be in a few hours for less than the cost of a needle.
Crazy.
That's the crazy stuff. But it gets even crazier when we can actually change the genome. We don't just read it, we write it.
Right.
And we can change genes, we can put new genes in very easily. There are drugs on the market. Most people may not realize, you may not realize that we can now, the FDA approved drugs, we are changing people's genetic diseases. We're curing genetic diseases.
Yes.
We are living in the future, man.
It's crazy.
But the future, for us, is going to be even crazier, because we are just on the cusp of hundreds of companies working on CRISPR and gene therapy. And this is the hottest thing in biotech right now.
I mean, imagine, everybody, the ability to interrupt the fact that you have a predisposition to heart disease or a form of cancer and interrupt that. How about this? Maybe this is nuts. Could we potentially interrupt somebody's and make them smarter? Could you change someone's intelligence through altering their genome? Could you do that?
Well, theoretically, there's a lot of genes involved in intelligence. Okay. And the brain has to be wired from an early age.
Okay.
But we know that drugs are capable of making you more intelligent, or at least give you more creativity. So we could do that, theoretically. But one of the things I'm excited about is being able to alter our bodies in ways that make us resistant to certain diseases.
Okay.
Heart disease, HIV. Now, we can get to that.
Go ahead.
There are two kids on this planet that were genetically modified to be resistant to HIV. Mm. That's craziness. Now, crazy to think about. Mm-hmm. Now, there's a whole debate. We in the world should start debating whether we want to not just help ourselves,
sure.
but do we want to make our kids resistant to heart disease, mm-hmm. to cancer. We know how to do this. Mm. If you said, David, could I make my kids resistant to cancer? Mm. That's easy. I could do that in my lab. One of my students could do it. It's not difficult. We know that there are species that live a lot longer than us. They have certain gene variants. Mm. They have special types of these longevity genes. Mm. Whales can live 200 years. Mm. We know pretty much what they're doing. They're stabilizing their epigenome, their DVDs don't get scratched as much. So whales can live 200 years. Hmm. So it's possible. Hmm. We know some of the genes that are involved. We could give ourselves that, or we could give our children that.
Why would we not? What are the negative implications of something like that?
Well, we just want to make sure it's safe. I think that's
meaning,
the main
what
one.
Else is it doing? Is that what you mean?
Right. You could make them intelligent, but they might then get cancer the next week.
I got
week.
You. So I want to make sure I pronounce it right. Senolytics. Am I saying that correctly?
Senolytics?
Yes.
Yeah.
What is it?
Well, they're exciting too.
Okay.
That's also been a breakthrough. So as I mentioned that before we figured out how to reprogram the body, the best technology and understanding we had were these hallmarks of aging. There are about eight
yes.
of these. And I mentioned some of them.
Yeah.
One of the main ones is senescent cells, which accumulate.
Right. Okay.
Right. So when you get a really bad scratch DVD, mm-hmm. when your cells forget what type of cell they are, they can kill themselves. But if they don't kill themselves, they become senescent. So what's senescent? They actually, instead of dying, they just sit there like zombies.
Yes.
And that'd be fine, except they start to secrete these factors that cause other cells that are healthy to grow old and defective. Inflammation is a big problem.
Yeah.
And we think that senescent cells are causing this problem. Okay. So senolytics is just a word for drugs that will kill off those cells when they're not dying themselves.
Got it.
And in mice, if you do that, they get rejuvenated.
Okay.
And they get younger.
Okay. I'm thinking through someone listening to this, because the typical person in my audience, I think, works out to look better or eats to look better. And I think the next level of consciousness, particularly, unfortunately, I found that anti-aging has almost become a space and an area where people with some affluence have been thinking about more than people that are just trying to get through life and improve their stock in life. And I don't like that part of it.
Yeah.
And so I know there are people listening to this going, this sounds good, I can't afford to get metformin. I'm probably not gonna take growth hormone, and I'm not sure that I should anyway. Resveratrol is relatively affordable for most people. You could probably get your hands on that potentially. But if you were to give me two or three, four basic things I could do to begin to reverse the aging process for me, would it be the caloric restriction? Would it be carbohydrates?
Yeah.
What would those few things be if I'm not able to get myself a couple of these medications that I should be putting in my body right away?
Yeah. Well, so I absolutely agree with you that we can talk about gene therapy for tens, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars, which is great if you're losing your vision, by the way, but these are not available to everybody.
Right.
And I just got back from Africa a few months ago, and you know, believe me, there are people in this world that don't care about anti-aging.
Sure.
We also don't call it anti-aging where I come from, because anti-aging is a whole group of people who are working on other things. So we call it longevity research. But what if there was one thing you asked me that I could give advice, or maybe a few things. Mm-hmm. The first would be eat less often. There are studies that have been done with my colleagues at the National Institute of Health. They gave mice, who have very similar metabolisms to us, very different diets. They wanted to know, is it better to eat more meat, or to eat more carbohydrate, or more fat?
Okay.
Big debate. Mm. And the result blew me away.
Okay.
He found that it wasn't better to eat more meat. He found it wasn't better to eat more fat, and it wasn't better to eat more carbohydrate.
Okay.
It wasn't what you ate. All those mice lived a normal lifespan.
How much you ate.
But the ones that ate it in a small time of day, 2 hours a day, lived 20% longer.
Wow.
So here's the take-home message.
Wow.
If that's right, it's not so much what you eat, it's when you eat that's important.
Okay.
And so I've gone on a diet where I restrict when I eat. I try not to eat breakfast, try not to eat lunch. That has made me feel a lot better. I'm sharper. And I think that I'm going to live longer because of that.
Okay.
So that's step one.
Okay.
And in fact, that saves money.
Sure, right?
Right. And don't overindulge in anything. Don't just eat all meat, in my view. Don't eat all fat. Okay. You want to mix it up. Trick your body. Oh, I'm running out of this. I'm running out of that. And even with resveratrol, don't have to take it every day. Take it every other day. Trick your body. Another thing that's cheap. Get off your ass.
Okay.
I typed a book, and I think I aged a lot writing this book, actually. But it was worth it. But if you don't get your body into a state of breathlessness or get your muscles to be tired and sore, your body will say, hey, everything's good. I don't need to fight diseases. I don't need to fight aging.
Okay.
So you lose your breath at least a few times a week if you can.
Okay.
Get on a treadmill. I think 40 minutes is great. 10 minutes is good.
Mm-hmm.
But anything is better than nothing.
Okay.
What else is good? So what I do when I go to the gym on Sunday with my son.
You go once a week.
Well, I try to go more.
Okay.
And I'm on planes a lot.
Yeah.
But I have a home gym, so I try to do a little bit. But I don't live a perfect life.
Mm-hmm.
It's maybe why I take extra molecules to try and supplement that.
Offset it.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But can I tell you, I finish work about midnight, so it's
yeah. You're in that mega achiever, multiple companies, your lab, all the work you do, children. You're at that point where, sometimes your fitness and your nutrition may take a back seat, right? Which is probably not healthy. One thing you didn't mention that I'm surprised, and I've not heard you talk about this, what about being happier? Yeah. So, and I know that's not part of the research necessarily, or maybe it is, but do happy people live longer?
They do. They always do.
Okay, so how come that's not part of what's talked about? Or is it just so anecdotal or silly that it's not discussed? But I would think happier people have less stress in their body, probably less inflammation in their body, just by not having that kind of stress.
It's true. It's true. But one of the reasons we don't talk about it is that we don't understand why it works.
Okay.
But
as a scientist, you have to be able to prove why it works.
Yeah, that's why people didn't regard aging as a disease, which I do. We didn't understand why aging happened, so we said,
okay,
it's natural, let's not deal with that. But now, like cancer, we understand, we think how it works. Mm. You can focus on that. Now it's okay to say it's a problem. Happiness, wishy-washy.
Okay.
But all of the centenarians, the people that live to 100, they're always happy
people.
That's
right. Right.
Right. Mind you, if I lived to 100, I'd be pretty happy too.
Right. No, there's a good point.
No, but they've been happy their whole life.
Yes.
And that's definitely works. But I haven't been happy my whole life. Mm-hmm. I'm a lot happier now that I'm 50 because I've learned what a bad day is, and most days are not bad days, even if you think they're bad.
Mm.
But yeah, early in my life, I was quite depressed, actually.
We talked a little bit about that off camera, so let's just go there for a few seconds. I've told you that the thing that surprised me the most, and I just think it should, here's somebody who's, arguably the best person in the world in their field, is doing work that has tremendous meaning. I mean, I don't know that you could do work that has more meaning to mankind than what you're doing right now outside of spiritual work. Yet, you're not always happy. You haven't always been happy in your life. And I think it's important that people know that, because I've told people that, on my show, the thing that surprised me the most, all these mega achievers, what do they all have in common? Some of it's work ethic, some of it's good fortune, some of it's intellect, but they don't all have those things. The vast majority struggle to some extent with a little bit of their mental health. Do you still, when I met you, when we just embraced when you first got here, I thought you had an ease and a, honestly, like an elegance about your personality. This is somebody very comfortable with themselves. But as I've started to watch you more, I wonder if there's this dude in there that's a little bit at battle with himself, that's wondering if he's not moving this at the speed that he should, if his work is not where he would like it to be.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm a perfectionist and an overachiever.
Mm.
I want to leave the world way better than I found it, at least somewhat better. And I find myself in a position of great responsibility. Now I'm at Harvard and I've got this research. So I'm maximizing my day without sacrificing my family as best I can. Mm. But early in my career, because I set such a high goal from an early age, ever since I was 4, I wanted to understand why we age and wake the world up. Why aren't we worried about this? This is not good. We treat cancer, we treat heart disease, we treat frailty, we treat Alzheimer's. Mm. But you know what causes all of those things? Aging. Why don't we care? And so I've always set that goal. And there were stages in my life where I thought I wasn't going to achieve anything.
Mm-hmm.
I saw that I was stuck in Australia.
Mm.
I just finished a Ph.D. There were no jobs for Ph.D.s.
Mm.
who was studying the sex life of a yeast cell. That's what I trained in.
That's awesome.
And I thought, what have I done? I've worked myself into such specialization, I'm not going to change the world. I might make some yeast happier, but that's about it. Yeah. And being inconsequential is worse than death for me. I want to wake up every day feeling as though I'm going to make a difference.
Being inconsequential is worse than death for you.
Yeah.
You know what occurred to me as you were saying it? You know, one of the obligations, responsibilities we all have is to create a life that we want to live longer for.
Right.
And so for the vast majority of you listening to this, you know, one of the things that is so important about all the things you listen to on my show, and particularly today, is how about we start creating a life that we can't wait to be around for longer in anticipation of? One of the things that makes me so excited about today's show, look, I do a lot of shows. I've been so looking forward, by the way, and it's exceeding my expectations, is because I've been in anticipation about the work you do. And I want to ask you about that from a business perspective, because we don't have that much more time, but there's a lot of entrepreneurs that listen to this.
Yeah.
So this is something I know you've not been asked, but this is also a serial entrepreneur, multiple businesses, a couple I'm going to make me get involved with. But if you were an entrepreneur, knowing that this, see, if someone could have knocked on my door in 1985 and said, hey, the internet's coming, maybe you ought to start thinking about that as a businessman. This thing's coming, this wave's coming. Start to think strategically about businesses, products, services, methods of delivery that could help there. I feel like what we're describing, this longevity industry, we'll call it that, is the next big wave. And if I were an entrepreneur listening to this, I'd be thinking, how do I prepare myself? What should I be thinking? What should I be looking at? So I know it's a difficult question,
yeah.
But what advice would you give to an entrepreneur who's hearing these things from you and all the possibilities that come along with it? What should they be thinking or doing?
Yeah. Well, so the world has changed a lot in the last few years. I was the first young guy to start companies on longevity.
Mm-hmm.
And if people are wondering, it's all on my website. I've started more than 15 companies. Mm-hmm. I've helped dozens, and I've taken 4 public.
Awesome.
I reinvest all that money, by the way, in startups and jobs and philanthropy. So
awesome.
I'm not trying to make money. I'm trying to leave the world
legacy.
Better. But if someone could have instructed me when I was young, what I would have said to them is, identify a trend, and if you don't have the money to invest, get involved in startups, but work with the best people.
Mm.
Don't work with mediocre people,
because
things are going to get really hard when you start up a company.
Mm.
Things are going to fail, you may be near bankruptcy, and you want to be with people that you can trust.
Mm.
So I don't work with assholes anymore. Done with that.
That's awesome.
Really, that's the first criterion. And you know, my friends are all like family to me, and vice versa. So that's actually one of the best bits about getting older, is you have this group of people you can trust. Mm. But from the outset, I wish that I had always worked with the best of the best.
Mm.
So look for that. If you have a little bit of money, you can invest in something like this. Some of these companies are just getting started.
Mm.
And the field is exploding.
Yes.
So I agree with you that longevity research is going to make the iPhone look like old news.
I do too. And I love what you said about trends and finding the best people. Those are two huge keys. If you're an entrepreneur thinking about this, you should be thinking about, what are the trends? How does it impact the business you're in currently? Right? What are the changes going to be there? Okay, I have one last question for you, because I'm just fascinated to know this. Are you afraid to die?
No.
You're not?
That's an easy question. In fact, I used to be afraid to die when I was in my 20s and 30s, because I wanted to see where things would go.
Yeah.
And there's this natural fear in all of us.
Mm-hmm.
But I now know that I'm not afraid, because I fly a lot, and a few times those planes were going down, and I had felt that I was going to die.
Hmm.
It was going to be sad that I'd miss my family. My family would have to do without me. But personally, I'm not worried about that. My wife is the opposite. She grabs under my arm and she's, I'm going to die. And I said, if we die, we die. She said, I don't want to die. Hmm. And I'm just like, as long as it's not too painful, I'm good with it.
Hmm.
So letting go of the fear of death was one of the best things I ever did in my life. Because now I can live without fear.
You got it.
That's the key.
That's why I ask you, David. I really believe that letting go of the fear of dying allows you to live freely now. Allows you to embrace it. And I gotta tell you, like, I'm more excited about life and where it's going and what the possibilities are because someone like you exists in the world. I'm like, I really admire you. And I'm glad we've become friends. You're gonna stick very close to me, just so you know, because I wanna live a long time. But because I'm not afraid to die, but I am excited to see what happens while I live. And I'd like to do it as long as I can.
Yeah, well, we're going to be friends because you're an inspiration. You do all the right things with your life. And,
thank you.
And
I don't do all the right things, but I know what you mean. I know exactly what I'm trying to do as good in the world. And I think we both have a lot in common that we want to make a difference in other people's lives and make a difference in the world.
Yeah.
And that line you said, I'm going to reflect on that tonight about living a life of an inconsequential life is worse than death.
Well, the reason I follow you is that I have bad days. Mm-hmm. I need inspiration. Mm-hmm. It's not all easy. Mm. And guys like you, we get inspiration from you, and you lift us up.
Thank you, brother. Man, I'm so glad I met you. Let's do one more time. I want to make sure they know where to follow you. I don't know if I've ever had an interview where I've felt more optimistic and learned more. I certainly learned the most today, that's for sure. But where do they find you? Where do you want them to go find you? You want to see you on Instagram, or where should they go?
Well, yeah, I'm on all social media.
Okay, and where do they find you? What are you under? We'll put it on the screen on YouTube.
But yeah, sure. We have a website called lifespanbook.com. Okay. You can sign up for a newsletter. I also tweet a lot, David A. Sinclair, and Instagram is David Sinclair, Ph.D.
Okay, wonderful. David, thank you so much today. I enjoyed this so much. I know you guys did in the audience as well. You got to share this. People need to know this information. Give them optimism, give them hope, and give them the strategies to live longer and live better right now. Thank you, Dr. David Sinclair. Everybody, you know that every day to engage with me, follow me on Instagram. We run the Max Out 2-Minute Drill every single day, which means when I make a post, which is 7:30 Pacific, 10:30 Eastern, Monday through Friday, first 2 to 5 minutes, make a comment, especially on this video. Make a comment, and you're in a drawing every single day. The other way that you can get in the drawing is to make a comment on people's comments, and if you miss the first 5 minutes, just make a comment every day on every post. We add up all those people and pick winners as well. You can ride on my jet. You get to meet some of my guests. You get Max Out gear. Come to see me speak live. All kinds of cool things happen. So get involved with the Max Out community on Instagram on the Max Out 2-Minute Drill. God bless you and continue to max out. Hey guys, thanks for sticking around. If you'd like more, click the videos right here. They're exactly what you need to see next. And if you're new here, hit subscribe and become a part of the Max Out community. And tell me what you think about the videos in the comments below. I read all of them every week, and I select winners that get all kinds of prizes, gear, coaching calls with me. Make a comment.